All right. So when I started my internship, that was 3 years ago, I was alone on a duty. My senior was on the other side. And then I received a young lady who came to me, and that young lady was 18 years old. And she was about to deliver. She was a very young, beautiful lady. When I tried to talk to her, she told me that she had to quit her school because of the pregnancy. And she went through the delivery processes. We ended up operating on her. And then after she was in hospital for 3 days, then she had to go back home. And then I saw her later on after something like 3 months when she came back with the kid. And then she told me that she haven't started school yet. So this is very imperative, that we start looking at teenage pregnancies. And believe me, they don't get pregnant by themselves. There's a man out there who is going to impregnate our young women. So this is the right time. We've got no time to waste. We need to act right now. So I'd like to thank Imbuto Foundation and UNFPA to have chosen this topic. I think this is what an innovator and a creator has to understand. If you don't understand that your health matters, you're not going to create anything. You're not going to be an innovator. It can't happen. So with all due respects, I'd like to welcome everyone in the room, and I'd like to recognize the very important people we've got. Our auntie and the Minister of Health, who is here today with us, I'd like to welcome her, and and I'd also like to welcome the Minister of Youth from Botswana, who is also in the room. Thank you so much. I'd like to recognize the different other dignitaries, some partners who are also in the rooms. I'm not going to mention any name because of, you know, the protocols. And right after me, there's going to come a moderator who is going to introduce our esteemed panelists. So before I go long, I'd like to tell those people who need translation kits, s'il vous plaît, si tu es dans la salle et tu vas besoin de la traduction, so you can raise your hand and someone is going to come and pick. Someone is coming with translation kits. So this session was prepared and is hosted by Imbuto Foundation and UNFPA. And it is a very great session, as I mentioned, and it really matters a lot, and it is very important. So I'm going to take you through the agenda of today. So we're going to have an opening remarks from the Imbuto Foundation. The deputy director is here to talk to us. Then after, there's going to be a documentary movie, a very short documentary movie that is going to talk to us about this topic. Right after, we have a great panel. Say panel. Repeat after me, panel. It's going to be amazing. And then after, there's going to be a time for young people to ask questions. This is our time, young people. It is our time. So you're going to have time to talk about this and to engage ourselves with this. Then after, there's going to be an intervention of someone. If you grew up in Rwanda, you've been listening to Urunana. Right? Do you know someone called Mariana? She's here in the room with us. All right, so we get that special intervention, and then we're going to have remarks from UNFPA country director, country representatives, and then we're going to have another special intervention of our guest of honor. So before some further ado, I've requested, believe me, and I'm very sorry for that, like I'm not going to mention everyone, but we recognize all the important people in the room, from partners, from friends who are here today. So with all due respect, feel welcomed and don't feel at home. Actually, this is a very mistake that so many people, they do. Don't feel at home. I don't know so many problems you have at home. Feel at Imbuto and feel at UNFPA because you don't have any issues. All right? Okay, so I'd like to call our tech people to get the video ready. And then we are live. We are live on Facebook and we are live on YouTube. So if you're not in the room and you're following us, please keep following us. You can also tweet us. The hashtag is The hashtag is, we're using Youth Connekt Africa 2018. So please tweet and keep, I mean, keep, if you're online, please be with us. We're going to keep having you. So before taking any other further time, let's welcome the video. Thank you.
Imibare igaragazwa n'ikigo cy'igihugu kibarurisha mibare mu cyegeranyo cyakozwe mu 2014 na 2015 igaragaza ko 23 n'ibice 6% by'abakobwa bafite hagati y'imyaka 18 na 19 bemera ko baba barakoze imibonano mpuzabitsina mbere yo kugira imyaka 18. Cyo kimwe n'abasaza babo bagera kuri 28 n'igice kimwe kw'ijana. Mu myaka 10 ishize, gutwita kw'abangavu mu Rwanda kwiyongereye ku kigereranyo cya 11 n'ibice 5%. Ibi nibyo byatumye Imbuto Foundation ku bufatanye na UNFPA bashyira mu bikorwa gahunda yo kwita ku bana b'abakobwa babyaye bakiri bato.
Dutangira iyi gahunda twayitewe n'ubushakashatsi bwakozwe n'ikigo cy'igihugu kibarurisha mibare cyagaragaje yuko mu bana batanu bafite imyaka 19 byibura umwe aba atwite cyangwa yarabyaye. Tugasanga nka Foundation Imbuto rero ni ikibazo dukwiriye kugira umusanzu dushobora gutanga kugira ngo turinde abataratwita cyangwa batarabyara ariko n'ababyaye nabo tubashe kubitaho mu bijyanye n'imibereho yabo myiza ndetse n'abana babavukaho.
Ubukene bukabije mu miryango, kutagira amakuru nyayo ku buzima bw'imyororokere ni zimwe mu mpamvu abakobwa bagaragaza zongera ibyago byo gutwita kw'abangavu.
Ntabwo nigaga, nakoraga akazi ko mu rugo. Ndi guteka araza anshyira mu nzu kuko ntago nari mwiteguye aramfata bigenda gutyo.
Umuhungu arafite 23 dukundanye ukwezi uko kwezi nyine kwaje kuvamo ahita mbwira ngo ntago haba umukobwa utanywa inzoga anyereza mu biyobyabwenge. Turangije kumwe n'ibiyobyabwenge turaryamana ahita antera inda.
Umuntu wanteye inda yaje muri karitsiye turamenyana turakundana. Tumaze gukundana ansaba ko nazaza kumusura ko ari ibyo yanguriye ashaka kuma. Namusanze Gisenyi ndamusura antera inda.
Mbere y'uko gahunda y'Imbuto Foundation yo kwita ku bana babyaye bakiri batitangira, aba bana b'abakobwa bamwe muri bo bari barirukanywe mu miryango, bahozwa ku nkeke ndetse bakanatotezwa n'abaturanyi.
Ubwo barabyaye bamujyana kwa muganga, igihe tuzanye umwana ise sekuru mbega ntiyabyakiriye neza, abarinje ugomeza kuba mu gahiragiro ntiyamugurira umwenda wo kwambara.
Gahunda y'Imbuto yo kwita ku bana b'abakobwa babyaye bakiri bato yafashije cyane ababyeyi kongera kunga ubumwe n'abana babo.
Uno mushinga gura twakura gutwakuye mbona n'ababyeyi ntabwo ari nje njenyine baratwigisha guhera icyo gihe umwana ndiyabaga mu rugo. Bamaze kutwigisha numva umutima guragarutse numva atangiye kumvugisha tutavuganaga.
Bamaze kumenya amakuru ku buzima bw'imyororokere uko ba bakwitwara hari umuntu ubashutse kandi bamaze noneho no gufata ingamba ku buryo nabo bashobora kugira icyerekezo cyo gushaka ubuzima bwo kwibeshaho no kubeshaho abana bafite.
Hari ikintu kinini cyahindutse kwa uriya mwana w'umukobwa ndetse no mu bandi bana ugasanga afite gahunda nuko n'ubworoherane cyane.
Nyuma yo guhabwa inyigisho, abana b'abakobwa babyaye bakiri bato benshi muri bo bahisemo gukoresha uburyo bwo kuboneza urubyaro bubabereye. Kimwe mu bigaragaza ubumwe bw'ababyeyi n'abana babo nyuma yo kugerwaho na gahunda y'Imbuto Foundation ni uko abana bamwe barasubijwe mu mashuri bakiga imyuga itandukanye. Aba bana b'abakobwa banigishijwe kwizigamira.
Ubu ngubu tumaze kugeza muri 1,300,000. Tuguza amafaranga tukajya gushaka ibintu dukora, kunguka ugashaka ukuntu wagura isabune, ukigurira umwambaro, amavuta yo kwisiga.
Imbuto Foundation igaragaza ko yishimiye ibyagezweho mu kugerageza ishyirwa mu bikorwa rya gahunda yo kwita ku bana b'abakobwa babyara bakiri bato.
Imbuto Foundation turakomeza gukora ubuvugizi ku nzego zitandukanye kugira ngo aba bana b'abangavu bakomeze kwitabwaho ndetse n'abana babavukaho. Ikindi nuko twifuza gukomeza gukora ubuvugizi kugira ngo iyi gahunda igere no mutundi turere kuko naho hari abana bafite ibyo bibazo. Twifuza kandi gukumira twigisha urubyiruko kugira ngo narwo rudakomeza kwishora mu mibonano mpuzabitsina bikaba byatuma batwita cyangwa batera inda zitateganijwe.
I was watching you from the side, no one was happy. And indeed, it is not something that would make us happy. So without taking so much time, I'd like to welcome the representative of Imbuto to come and actually tell us more on their work. Can we give a round of applause as we welcome her? Thank you so much.
Thank you, MC. Good afternoon, everyone. We are very honored to have this session. I think the video speaks from itself. Everyone understand. You may have in your family a teen mother and a teen father. So, dear connected youth, honorable ministers, valued partners, all protocol observed, let me begin by expressing my gratitude to you all for attending this session of Youth Connekt Africa Summit. Teen pregnancy in Africa is a pertinent issue that deserves focused attention and innovative solutions. It is therefore timely and right that we should discuss this issue at this summit as we are talking about transforming Africa. And this will help us to bring together young people and innovative minds from across the continent. I was discussing with the Honorable Minister of Botswana, and he was really talking about the program they have in their country. And I think this is what we call the Youth Connekt, that connection that is really coming out among the Africans and other partners from a different continent. Teen pregnancy has been of a very bad impact, which touches various sectors in our countries and on our continent. It raises questions about our health and education systems and the standard of living of all Africans as a whole. Though young girls mainly bear the brunt, teen pregnancy negatively impacts boys, parents, and entire communities as well. To the young girls, it often means an interruption of their education aspirations, a life of discrimination and stigma from their families, friends, and communities. And I think you heard about examples in that video. Imbuto Foundation has worked on projects and with people whose experiences are considered taboo. Earlier in 2005, our chairperson, Her Excellency Mrs. Janet Kagame, the First Lady of Rwanda, launched a continental program or a campaign known as Treat Every Child as Your Own. The campaign had three phases, of which the second phase's theme was speak to your children about sex. It may save their lives. Our African first ladies have already set a tone to protect our children, our young people. Our very first programs were initiated to respond to families affected by HIV and AIDS, of which some were dealing with the overwhelming consequences of rape due to the genocide against the Tutsi 20 years later. Through these experiences, we learned that to effectively responding to these issues, we need to start by breaking the silence. And this is the exercise we are going to have today. We are going to have a straight talk. The rising rate of teenage pregnancy in our countries and communities should be our motivation to indeed have a straight talk about this issue and deep into the understanding for root causes and search for effective solutions. At Imbuto Foundation, the First Time Young Mothers Program is one of our flagship programs together with UNFPA, Minister of Health, Minister of Gender and Family Promotion, and other partners. Through it, we are providing an integrated package, and I think you have seen that, of interventions which focus on providing psychosocial support, parent-adolescent communication, community-based outreach, and income-generating activities as some of the means of ensuring social reintegration. We have leveraged the youth themselves by creating adolescent sexual reproductive health clubs run and led by them. Through these clubs, we train peer educators and they have to share life-changing information through sessions held in schools and out of school. These clubs are also linked to community health centers in which two trained nurses are available to provide youth-friendly services and also visit clubs within there to impart information and answer pertinent questions. We now have 156 out-of-school clubs and are implementing this program in 107 schools. Distinguished delegates, despite our progress, we are still scratching the surface. We need to do more. Think outside the box. Bring together the young people to find solutions to this issue and share best practices if we are to end teenage pregnancies and transform Africa. Let me use this opportunity to have a honest conversation about teen pregnancy with hope of going away with new ideas on potential interventions, but specifically to engage our young men and boys to also take part of this conversation and actions. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much, Deputy Didi, for that very, very, very good message to young people and to everyone in the room. I'm actually going to quote two things that she mentioned. She said that this is the time to break the narrative, to break the silence, and straight talk. Do you know what a straight talk means? A straight talk means, to me, that they will tell you, you didn't come after time. They will tell you you're late, and then you're staying outside. You know that kind of a thing when you're late at work and you're like, go back. So we need to be, you know, to have this straight talk and talk about why is this an issue. I'd like also to thank the Deputy DG for this message. And please give our thanks to the whole office of the Imbuto Foundation, including Her Excellency, the First Lady, for this vision for our young people, our young ladies in this country. I would like to thank what they are doing and to commend their work and their effort to make sure that we can tackle this. And at least if someone has had that issue, there's a way to take care of them and to even let them, to give them hope and encouragement to come back to life and to work. So I would like to welcome Malyse. Malyse Uwase is, she's working with Kasha Rwanda, and she's actually now at the regional level. She's coordinating the activities at the regional level, not just in Rwanda, but also in Kenya. She went to University of Boston, where she did her master's in global health, and she's going to be our esteemed moderator for the upcoming session. Let's have a big round of applause for coming, Malyse.
Thank you so much for the introduction, and good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here and honored to be moderating a panel on a health topic. And like many of the previous speakers said, it's one that is not easy to discuss and that is also quite complex. When I was preparing for this session, I also asked I asked some of my friends if they would be interested in coming. And some of my guy friends said, no, it's about teen pregnancy. That is a women and girls issue. And some of my girlfriends asked, are there gonna be other young men present in the room? Are there gonna be people from other generation, to put it this way? And the reason why they were asking these questions was to assess if it was really going to be a straight talk. And what these two exercises made me realize is that, first, we're still not comfortable discussing this issue of teen pregnancy, but also based on someone's background, they might view it as a health issue, an economic issue, a women and gender issue, or a social and cultural issue. But the reality is that it's all of these issues combined, and that's why it concerns all of us. And especially as we're here gathered for Youth Connekt and talking about Africa's transformation, we need to push ourselves and really think outside of the boundary and be comfortable or uncomfortable discussing any topic that is affecting us and keeping us from reaching our potential. So this is why I'm very glad to see when I look at the room that we do have young women, young men, people from other generations, as well as people that are leading implementation and policy. I know that what they want to do is to hear from us, the young people. So this is a session for us. This is why it's a straight talk. And I do encourage the audience to engage with us as we go through this panel session. Some of you may have a paper that says yes or no under your chair. If you do, some of the questions I will be asking as well the audience to engage and to provide your opinion. Feel free to raise a yes if you agree. And if you disagree, you can raise a no. And so with no further ado, let me introduce our esteemed panelists. Our first panelist is Mr. Davide Piga, who is an Innovation and Knowledge Management Program Specialist at UNFPA East and Southern Africa Regional Office in Johannesburg. In particular, Davide leads the UNFPA Innovation Accelerator, known in Rwanda as iAccelerator. This is an initiative that aims to explore new and engaging ways to tackle pressing population challenges while promoting social entrepreneurship among young people. I think he's already on stage, but please help me welcome. Our second panelist is Madame Rose Rwabuhihi, Chief Gender Monitor. She leads the Gender Monitoring Office in Rwanda, a government institution entrusted to ensure the accountability of public and private institutions in implementing gender equality in Rwanda. Prior to joining the government of Rwanda, she worked for more than 15 years for the United Nations in several African countries and the United States. Please help me welcome the Chief Gender Monitor. Our next panelist is Marthe Bulambo Muyangi from the Democratic Republic of Congo. She works for the Swiss Tropical and Public Health Institute as a technical assistant in Bukavu. She specifically works with schools to integrate comprehensive sexual education into their curriculums, as well as various organizations that teach sexual and reproductive health to community members. Please help me welcome Marie to the panel. Our final panelist, and also the youngest one, is Dr. Marie, as well, Lingwe, who trained in general medicine in Hungary. She's from Rwanda. She's been back home and practicing for a year now, and she's also a blogger who likes to write about culture. Please help me welcome Dr. Marie. So I was welcoming everyone to the panel, and since we're talking about a topic that is affecting so many young girls, especially in low-income countries, I wanted to start us off with a few numbers from the World Health Organization. So in low-income countries, it is estimated that 16 million girls between the ages of 15 to 19 give birth every year. In addition, there are 2 million girls under the age of 15 that are also giving birth. Therefore, it is an issue that is really affecting a lot of young girls at the global level and specifically in low-income country. And so my first question addressed to all the panelists is to really, for such a huge number, to understand some of the root causes of this issue. If we can have each panelist share with us at least one or two main root causes of teen pregnancy. And we can start at the end. Yes.
Thank you. I only want to mention one, which I believe is a very important root cause, which is access to information on sexual and reproductive health, because it's an enabler. If you don't have the information that you need to make informed decisions on matters that will affect the rest of your life, then it's not guaranteed that you will make the right choices, and you will potentially end up in a situation that you might not have chosen. So that's why I believe that access to quality information is a root cause. The lack of it is a big cause of problems.
Thank you, Mr. Davide.
Thank you, moderator. I think that so many causes, root causes of teen pregnancies, but I'll come to the power of negotiation. The power of negotiation, because in our culture, especially in Africa, we have not raised our girls to say no and to stand on their grounds when they don't think something is not really good for them. When we look at the video and you saw they're talking about the way they get pregnant, it is like they didn't want, but they did it. I think that is one thing we have really to look at, the capacity and the willingness and the power to say no when you want to say no or when you have a doubt. So I think that is one of the causes.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Il n'y a pas de problème.
Donc, l'autre cause que moi je sais, c'est par rapport au dialogue entre les éducateurs, les parents, les enseignants et les jeunes. Donc, il n'y a pas ce dialogue-là par rapport à l'éducation sexuelle complète. Les parents et les éducateurs qui devraient normalement donner l'information, les premières informations aux jeunes, ils ont laissé leur travail. Et les jeunes commencent à prendre l'information dans la route, dans la rue, chez les autres jeunes, et parfois ce ne sont pas des bonnes informations.
Merci beaucoup.
Right, so I think I'm just going to summarize what they said, because they pretty much said everything. Like they said, there's the lack of information. These teenagers don't know what they're doing, if you think about it. They don't get the info. They're not getting it from their teachers. They're not getting it from their parents because it's taboo in Africa. And on top of that, if you look at the video, poverty is one of the main causes. They kept saying, I didn't have anything to do. I was a worker in someone's house. You realize that a lot of it is also centered around poverty. So that's what I think is causing teenage pregnancies.
Thank you all for your contributions. So I heard lack of access to adequate information, and that has been said by more than one panelist. Also, the power of negotiation, which is really important for young girls, and conversation between young people and maybe their parents as well as teachers, and poverty. So I wanted to maybe gauge the audience opinion. If you have the yes or no paper, who agrees when it comes to access to information? Who thinks it's one of the main root causes of teen pregnancy? Okay, so I think there are more yeses than no. What about the power of negotiation for young girls specifically? Okay, so I don't even see a no. What about... Okay, I know, but the majority is still yes. How about increasing conversations between young people, their parents, teachers, so different discussions among people from different generations? Okay, so still majority is yes. And poverty as also a cause? Okay, I see some no, but I think Perhaps the main takeaway from even this exercise is that we're talking about this issue at a continental level, and each country in Africa is also unique. And so for some countries, some root causes might make more sense than others, but the idea is that each of us can think about our own specific country and see what are the main root causes, and then start thinking about how to implement solutions. And some are across all countries, and others are unique. So thank you so much for your really thoughtful, insightful feedback and comments. To sort of transition, still along the theme of this session, this question is for the Chief Gender Monitor. The theme of this session is transforming Africa through the prevention of teen pregnancy. Why do you think preventing teen pregnancy can transform Africa? And what is required to get to that transformation? And also, maybe you can highlight a few programs in Rwanda that are being implemented to address this issue. So multiple questions in one. Thank you.
I think we have all agreed that is a big issue that everybody has to address. In Africa, I think all the countries, there is no single country that didn't really have that kind of issue and tried to address it. And from Cairo, ICPD, to Maputo, to the SDGs, to the last Millennium Goals, I think the issue of teen pregnancies has been discussed, because we do understand all that is really a problem for Africa, not only for Africa, for everywhere, and for all the families and for all the people who are really getting through that experience that is very painful, as you saw it. It is very important that young girls can really contribute. They can, as boys, as men and women of our continent, it is very critical that they can really offer the whole capacity they have in themselves to contribute to the development of this country, of this continent. And it is impossible when you are pregnant at 12, 13, 14, it is impossible that you can really produce what you are expected to produce. You can't raise a kid at 13 when you are still a kid, and you can't really offer what you can offer because your potential has been stopped in the middle of the course of your life. It is very critical if we wanted to transform Africa that we really change the attitudes, we change the society, we change the rules of engagement between boys and girls, and between really girls themselves and boys themselves. Because sometimes what we have seen is that some girls can also push peer girls to really start when it is not yet time, but also boys. And I think one of the challenges that we have in Africa, we have been addressing sexuality in a way that it is a taboo. And because it is a taboo, it is not addressed, it is not discussed, it is hidden, but it is happening. And what is happening is that, for example, if you really want that our population that is growing, that we really reap the population dividend, we have to have a youth that is capable of really taking care of themselves, of the kids they are bringing to this world. So it is very important that we have a youth that is responsible, we have a youth that can really contribute to development of the different countries, and if we don't address this teen pregnancy issue, we will still have those babies who don't have fathers, who have mothers who are still kids, and we will still have the cycle of poverty, of disease, etc. I think it's something that we should really address.
Thank you so much, and I do agree that, for example, for me, coming from a health background, I may think it's only about health, but it's also everything beyond that. Once that girl has given birth and she's healthy with her baby, but what becomes of her education? What else is the country gonna miss? Because if she doesn't continue her education, there is an employment opportunity that she's missing. There is also, so this is an issue that we can also look at from an economic standpoint. And so that was very strong of us to remember And that's why in thinking about transforming Africa, it does play a role, even if it's primarily a health issue. Thank you. The next question, I wanted us to maybe, we've talked about the root causes, we're talking about how preventing teen pregnancy can transform Africa, but I also wanted us to hear from someone that has been working with young people and specifically helping them into coming up with innovative solutions to address sexual and reproductive health issue. So the next question is for Mr. Davide Piga. You have been working with many young people on the continent to come up with innovative solutions to address sexual and reproductive health issues in an innovative way. What have you so far learned from this experience? And of all the pitches you've heard, what is the one that surprised you the most? What company surprised you the most?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for the question. And let me start by briefly telling you the story of this initiative that you mentioned. It's called the Innovation Accelerator, the UNFPA Innovation Accelerator. And I'll tell you what it is and what makes it stand out in this beautiful crowd of innovative initiatives that are being showcased in this event, all of them aimed at empowering young people. The UNFPA Innovation Accelerator was born in 2016 out of a simple yet complex challenge, which is how can we tackle complex development challenges, in particular sexual and reproductive health challenges, while at the same time creating job opportunities for young people. How can, therefore, UNFPA, an organization which is passionately committed to delivering a world in which each pregnancy is wanted, each childbirth is safe, and every young person's potential is fulfilled, how can this organization help young people take charge in solving challenges that affect them, while at the same time helping them make money? Now, the answer was social entrepreneurship. Social entrepreneurship is a powerful driver of innovation. It is basically about making businesses that make money and at the same time have a social impact. And there are lots and lots of initiatives in Africa aimed at helping young people setting up their businesses, but how many of them focus on social businesses and how many of them put an emphasis on sexual and reproductive health? Not very many, and that's why we decided to step into the space, because we believe that sexual and reproductive health should be a priority if you want to set up a business. After all, without being able to conduct a healthy lifestyle, you won't be able to run a successful business. Health is the foundation of a successful life, and I would say the sexual and reproductive health is a foundation of you being able to choose the life you want to live, because you have to have the information that you need to be able to decide to finish your studies and set up your business rather than being pregnant at an age when you wouldn't necessarily probably want to be pregnant. So with this idea in mind, we started partnering with innovation hubs, business incubators in a number of countries, and we started asking young people in these countries, what is that perfect product or service which you yourself would utilize to be able to access quality information on sexual and reproductive health. And if you design, we told the young people, if you design this product or this service, we will give you, UNFPA will give you money to develop a prototype, and most importantly, we will enroll you in a mentorship program, an acceleration or incubation program. Basically, we will help you setting up your business so that you will be able to provide these products or this service at scale. And in a little over a year, I believe it's about a year and a half, we saw 19 social enterprises coming out of the program in four countries, four of them only just in Rwanda. And of course, I don't have the time to tell you about each one of them, even though each one of them does deserve a mention. What I can say that it's amazing how diverse, how inventive, how creative these solutions are. We have everything from artificial intelligence to comic books, There is a team of young people in Uganda who decided to revolutionize the way patient data is collected and analyzed in hospitals. And in Rwanda, I want to mention a team of two people, a brother and a sister, who came together as a team to address the problem of the lack of quality information, access to quality information on sexual and reproductive health for young people in refugee camps. And they decided, these are two medical students, they have pretty busy lives, and on the side they decided to set up this business which is called Tantine, which is basically a website and a mobile application that makes it easier for people in refugee camps to access the information they need to make informed decisions. And I don't know if we have a minute, we could maybe show a video of it.
So, no, unfortunately.
Okay, yes. We'll skip.
Okay. Thank you so much. And I think it's very powerful as well. When you're talking about innovation and working with young people, we're talking about an issue. But there is a way we can solve it by creating employment opportunities and owning our own businesses. So thinking in a way of what can we do for our communities, it's not always, we might think it's volunteering or the only way to do it is through public institutions, but also from the private sector, we can intervene and do something. So thank you. We have also talked previously about the importance of information and specifically sharing the right information. And this next question is for Marie, not Dr. Marie. I'll make it in French to make it easier. So, Marie, donc actuellement, vous travaillez dans le milieu scolaire et extrascolaire pour introduire un curriculum d'éducation sexuelle complète. Quels sont les défis que vous rencontrez? Comment est-ce que les professeurs, les jeunes et autres membres de la communauté réagissent face à cette introduction?
Merci beaucoup. Par rapport à ça, le défi, le grand défi que nous rencontrons, c'est d'abord l'acceptation de l'éducation sexuelle complète par les parents. Parce que dans l'éducation, nous devons faire des parents nos alliés. Mais lorsque les parents n'ont pas encore accepté ce concept d'éducation sexuelle, là, il y a encore un problème. Mais avec ça, nous avons mis en place l'approche d'aller aussi vers les parents pour qu'on puisse expliquer aux parents de quoi est-ce qu'il s'agit, mais aussi montrer aux parents que, avec les informations que nous pouvons donner aux jeunes, nous tous, nous pouvons gagner. C'est-à-dire que les enfants sont nos enfants, nous tous, et si nous éduquons ensemble nos enfants, si nous parvenons à donner des compétences de vie courante aux enfants, ce sont nous tous qui allons gagner. Et alors, avec ça, les parents, les leaders communautaires, les leaders religieux, donc tous ceux qui sont des décideurs et tous ceux qui sont là pour aider les enfants, nous les impliquons dans le processus. Et nous essayons de leur faire comprendre de telle sorte que ce sont maintenant eux qui vont vers les autres parents pour créer ces changements-là. Ce sont eux qui deviennent nos leaders auprès des autres parents. Et c'est ça le grand problème auquel nous heurtons.
Thank you very much. Her feedback was that in introducing comprehensive sexual education into schools, one of the biggest challenges is convincing parents that it is good for their children. And that having that conversation with parents so that they're supportive goes a long way and makes the introduction easier. So the final question, because I know we're a little bit pressed for time since we started after the originally predicted time, is for Dr. Marie. Dr. Mary, I know you have been working for a little while now in Rwanda, and I was curious to know, when you're receiving young patients, especially in need of sexual and reproductive health services in Rwanda, what is the thing that stands out to you the most?
Thanks, Malyse. So, before I started working, my impression was that these kids are getting pregnant because they don't have access to contraception. That's what I thought. And I kept insisting that contraception should be available in schools, it should be available everywhere. And to my surprise, it is available, it's actually free. in some hospitals. But then I had a case where a patient of mine, she was 17, she was pregnant, she refused the contraception. It's there, it's free, she doesn't want it. And when you ask her why, she doesn't have an answer. It's just, no, I don't think it's a good idea, or I've heard terrible things about contraception. And she's heard it from who? The other mamas. And that's what's happening out there. It's, and most people think it's just, yeah, the problem is with the teens. The teens are having sex. But really, if you think about it, the problem is on the parents' side, the older people. And another challenge, something else I noticed is we have all these older people training and educating the younger ones about sex. To be honest, we're not really comfortable talking to the older people about these things. They're actually much more comfortable talking to someone like me than to talk to someone like them. No offense, but it's true. That's what's happening. I have my patients waiting for the nurses and for their parents to get out and go like, psst, doctor, I have this question, and they're really embarrassed about it. But then they talk to me because I look like them and I can be open about everything with them. While the parents, the truth is, their whole life, they learn that sex is taboo. That's it. So how do you tell that person to go teach about comprehensive sexual education? They can't. As much as you want them to, they really can't. And when we ask them to do it, when I tell them, let me do it, it becomes too comprehensive for them. Then, anyways, I think I've answered your question. I think the shocking part was mostly realizing that they just don't want the contraception coming after the stories they've heard. And they're basically not educated about it.
Yeah. So again, lack of information, a very strong theme, and trying to work on conversation between parents and young people. For all parents here, I hope you're hearing the message. Since we are running out of time, I wanted to move directly into the Q&A session. If we could get some assistance in providing microphones to people that might have questions. We'll take 3 or 4 maximum. Ooh. Okay, they're coming. It's 3 or 4. Okay. Oh, okay. So there's the young lady at the front. If you could start with her.
Bonsoir à tous. J'aimerais bien parler en français. Je suis Diana Zama. Je viens de la RDC. République démocratique du Congo. Et je suis fondatrice d'une petite organisation qui encadre les jeunes filles, mères et orphelines dans la prévention des mariages précoces et grossesses précoces, telles que nous sommes en train de parler maintenant. Je suis toujours choquée, vraiment choquée, quand il n'y a que des discours qui se parlent en ces sujets. Parce que moi-même, je me dis, je suis la petite fille d'hier, la grande fille d'aujourd'hui et la grande dame de demain. Et on ignore tous cela quand on investit dans la femme, c'est investir toute une économie d'un pays. Donc, je voulais à ce point ajouter sur les causes. Peut-être que vous n'avez pas eu à parler. Il y a aussi l'autre cause qui est aussi importante et qui est la déstructuration familiale, le divorce. Et à chaque fois qu'il y a un divorce dans une famille, c'est la fille entre parenthèses qui est victime toujours. Dans quel sens? La maman peut se remarier et la fille peut être victime de son beau-père et être même abusée. Et ce point-là est toujours dans le silence et partout en Afrique. Parce qu'on ne peut pas parler. Parce que c'est une fille, si tu oses de parler, c'est le mari de ta maman, c'est ton beau-père. Et dans ce sens-là, il y a nos coutumes, nos coutumes, qui interdit, qui fait taire cette fille-là. Et aussi, si c'était le cas du parent, comme on a dit,
D'accord. J'aimerais bien poser la question. J'ai oublié le nom, excuse-moi. Comment on peut dire oui? Parce que vous avez dit how to say no. Quand il n'y a pas une conversation, il n'y a pas un dialogue entre la maman et sa fille. Et c'est vraiment la cause. Et moi, j'ai eu toutes ces causes-là quand je faisais l'interview avec les filles dans l'association. Ce n'est pas quelque chose, qu'on a estimé ou on a pensé. Ce sont des choses réelles. Comment cette fille pourrait arriver à dire oui entre la coutume, entre les églises et entre sa maman? Merci.
Let's take, would you like to address the question?
Merci beaucoup pour la question. C'est une question très pertinente. Entre la coutume, entre l'église, tu peux ajouter entre la famille et beaucoup d'autres choses. C'est vrai que ce n'est pas facile de prendre une décision. Mais je pense qu'il est grand temps qu'on apprenne à nos enfants à faire des jugements qui concernent leur vie. Parce que nous sommes en train de parler de la contraception pour la jeunesse. C'est une grande décision. C'est une importante décision pour la vie. Quand on fait un bébé qu'on ne sait pas ce qu'on va en faire et qu'on ne l'a pas décidé, je pense que c'est pour cela que nous voyons très souvent quand ces filles tombent enceintes, they are broken, elles sont complètement... Ils sont complètement... déboussolées, elles n'ont plus rien à quoi s'attacher parce qu'elles pensent qu'elles ont commis quelque chose d'inacceptable, parce qu'elles n'ont pas accepté en elles de faire cet enfant. Et quand elles font des relations avec un garçon, très souvent, elles n'ont pas vraiment saisi toutes les conséquences qui vont découler de son acte. Quand nous parlons de prendre des décisions, de dire oui ou non, ce n'est pas seulement dire oui ou non aux parents, à la coutume, etc., mais c'est aussi de dire non à la personne qui veut vous engager dans une relation dont vous savez que vous n'êtes pas préparé pour. Mais c'est aussi de pouvoir prendre des décisions quand on doit prendre la contraception, quand on doit prendre des décisions qui concernent votre vie, c'est très difficile d'aller contre la famille, c'est très difficile d'aller contre la coutume, c'est très difficile d'aller même contre soi-même, parce que des fois, vous pouvez aller contre vous-même. Mais je pense qu'il est grand temps qu'on apprenne aux enfants à réfléchir et à dire non quand il faut dire non. Si on n'est pas prêt, on n'est pas prêt. Mais si on a eu la malchance de faire quelque chose qui vous amène dans un autre niveau où vous devez encore prendre des responsabilités. À 14 ans, vous avez un bébé. Ça veut dire que vous êtes une maman à part entière. Vous devez vous occuper de l'enfant. Vous devez chercher de quoi le nourrir. Vous devez continuer à aller à l'école si vous avez les moyens de le faire. Vous avez dépassé, vous êtes allé très vite en besogne et vous devez pouvoir réfléchir très vite et prendre des décisions. Et je pense qu'il est temps que pour nous, la société, la famille, ceux qui sont les gardiens de la tradition, il est grand temps qu'on regarde les choses en face. Si quelque chose s'est passé, il y a des choses qui doivent se faire. Et je pense que c'est pour la jeunesse, pas seulement pour les filles, je parle aussi pour les garçons. Parce que quelqu'un l'a dit, je crois que c'est notre modérateur principal qui a dit que, bon, écoutez, les enfants, les filles ne font pas seuls les enfants. Ils les font avec des garçons. Et j'aimerais bien dans cette audience aussi que les garçons nous parlent et nous disent qu'est-ce qu'ils pensent. Quand ils ont des relations avec les filles, ils savent très bien qu'il y a une grossesse qui peut en découler. Il y a un bébé qui va naître. Il y a un être humain qui a besoin d'un papa et d'une maman. Et c'est pour cela qu'il faut prendre des décisions. Pour cela qu'il faut oser braver le monde. Il faut oser braver les opinions des autres. Il faut oser braver les tabous. Il faut savoir dire non ou oui. Ça dépend.
Merci. Merci beaucoup. So, yes, let's take 3 additional questions and then we'll answer all of them at once. Okay. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm called Alexandre Morinzi. I'm Vice President of International Youth Alliance for Family Planning in Rwanda. I'm also an accelerator finalist in Rwanda and medical student. My question is, teenage pregnancy is a serious problem, we see it. And we are trying to solve that problem by providing information to the teenagers. But for me, I think we should go beyond providing information only. We should try to deal with behavior change, because you may tell the young person, use condom, and he doesn't use it. And they know also the importance of contraception, and they are not using them, as you've told us. They know the bad consequences of using drugs, that it's very risky, but they are still taking them. So I think, what do you think about bringing interventions that influence the behavior change? Because, for example, in Rwanda...
We're pressed for time, what is your question,
please? Let's make it brief. Like, for example, in Rwanda, we tried to fight against non-communicable diseases, and the country was awarded due to Carefree Day initiative, for example, and it's good. And can we seek other interventions that can, if we beat NCDs, we can also beat teen pregnancies? Lastly, iAccelerator initiative is very good. As a finalist, I got mentorship from it, and I would like to ask if there will be second phase of it, because it's really a good program, and as I was in top 10, I think that my project is refined, it can be better. Thank you very much.
I have both of your questions.
And I'm sorry.
Thank you. It's okay. So please, let's try, because if we're quick, more people can ask questions, right? So just stand up, please, your name, and then the question.
Hi. I have been living and waiting for this moment, for this exact panel. This is the reason I came. Anyway, I'm called Elizabeth Kemjisha, and I serve as a social behavior change communications coordinator in Kampala, in an organization in Kampala. So thank you very, very much for this panel. I want to applaud Rwanda and the Minister of Health. You are working under policies and an enabled environment. Yeah? You know what I mean? You can have this you can have these conversations today about teenage pregnancy, and it's a problem, and you know you're talking about access to information for parents to come onto the table and things like that. But I want to ask, most likely the panel may not be able to answer this question, but if they are, I'll be glad. Is people who are here, what is working under situations where the environment is not enabling, where the policies are not there for young people to actually get these services and this information? You know, people who are not, where you know the law says you have to be 18 to get contraception. What are you doing? I want to know what is working. So after this, if I can have conversation with some people, I would be glad. I also want to upload the free contraception. I am eager to know, how does this work? Is it at facilities? Is it, are they the private facilities? Is it, you know, how is it working? Free contraception for young people. I also...
Thank you. Let's do two questions. Thank you. So, two additional ones.
Merci. Bonjour à tout le monde. Je suis Gabriel Chokomakwa. Je suis chargé de programme adolescents et jeunes à UNFPA Cameroun. Je m'excuse de parler peut-être à la place des garçons et des filles, des adolescents et des jeunes, mais je voudrais dire que la question de la prévention des grossesses précoces, des grossesses non désirées aussi dans certains cas, et forcément par rapport aux adolescentes, interpelle à plus d'un titre par rapport à la question de l'éducation complète à la sexualité. Et je crois que les panélistes l'ont si bien abordé que je voudrais dire que au moins les trois déclinaisons au niveau scolaire, extrascolaire, notamment les statuts d'encadrement des jeunes, mais aussi communautaires, doivent être adressées toutes à la fois. Je crois que nos pays feraient un saut qualitatif et quantitatif dans la prévention des grossesses non désirées, surtout les grossesses précoces, le jour où on va institutionnaliser l'éducation complète à la sexualité dans tous les établissements, dans les programmes scolaires. Ce jour-là, on aura franchi un gros palier. Maintenant, il y a d'autres déclinaisons, comme je l'ai dit, dans les structures extrascolaires d'encadrement des jeunes et surtout des jeunes filles, mais aussi au niveau communautaire, par rapport aux relations parents-enfants, référents communautaires, etc. À la fin, c'est un petit groupé qui devrait pouvoir aboutir à faire basculer dans le sens positif la tendance. Et la petite nuance aussi que j'ai voulu relever, c'est que parfois, à cause des tabous, quand on aborde la question avec les parents en parlant d'éducation sexuelle, c'est très vite mal perçu. Je crois que le terme anglo-saxon le dit mieux quand on parle de comprehensive sexuality education. C'est assez clair. Et si on ne dit pas éducation complète à la sexualité étant ici un peu plus vaste et qui aborde plusieurs autres aspects à la fois, les parents qui ne sont pas toujours au fait de la question peuvent se rebiffer, peuvent se retracter et se dire, ben tiens, quelle est cette histoire d'éducation sexuelle? Qu'est-ce qu'on veut dire à nos enfants? Donc, je veux dire qu'il y a une approche qui doit être multidimensionnelle, qui adresse plusieurs catégories de personnes, les parents, les décideurs, les référents communautaires, mais aussi et surtout les jeunes eux-mêmes, qui doivent être responsabilisés dans l'approche d'éducation de leur père et même autour d'eux, par rapport à ceux qui, parfois, influencent assez négativement les comportements de nos enfants. Notamment, c'est un parent direct. Parfois,
merci.
C'est des...
Merci. Malheureusement, à cause du temps. Merci. One last question at the front. Now, we already have... Oh. Okay.
The last one. I think it's on. Okay. Thank you very... Can I? Yeah?
Yes.
I thank can. You.
Yes, let's take my name, a question and then... Yeah. Okay.
A quick one. So my name is Siobhan Biamkam. I work for a digital health company here in Rwanda. We recently did something called Turakumva, where people can, you know, youth can call in and speak to us. We are to medical professionals. And we realized that about 70% of the people that are calling in are young girls. And while we said ask anything, 90% of what they're asking for is sexual reproductive health. So that means that people are yearning to listen to this information. So where do youth go? People are in school. One of the things I wanted to recommend is to have counselors in schools. And it's not just for girls, but also boys, because boys are equally as affected as girls. Education change needs to be both for girls and for boys. And my last intervention, and only because you said we're going to give straight talk, yes. I wanted to talk about abortions. I think this is a conversation we're all not having, but we all know. And because it's illegal, nobody's going to risk their practice to carry out abortions in places. And therefore, the places that people go are dingy places that people go and do abortions there. So is anybody tracking the deaths that are happening as a result? Is anybody having conversations about this? While I agree it should remain illegal, what is the conversation around abortions in Africa? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. My name is Christine Omutoni. I'm the UN resident coordinator, UNDP representative in Mauritius and Seychelles, and proudly Rwandan. the MC, I think, after the video, looked at everybody's face and said, "You must be sad." And in my mind, I was glowing. I was actually happy. You would say why? Because for me to see a young Rwandan woman on a microphone speaking about those problems, about what they are facing, knowing the culture, knowing where we are coming from, I really want a person having a program that makes them reunify with the family, that there's a law that protects them, there is a gender observatory. So, coming from a situation where we were begging girls, women who had been raped during the genocide to go in Arusha to testify so that rape can be a crime against humanity. Coming from all that, anyway, to cut the long story, for me, I want to applaud the efforts. And it's like coming from negative 40 and you are negative 30, negative 20 until you are, for when I see things here now, at that time, now it's like you want to go from 50 to 60. But my question is, while I applaud everybody in these efforts, I think somebody mentioned about it. I wish I could also see a video there of the same boys who made those girls pregnant also testify. some sort of a video alongside them also saying what they have to do about it. I know there are programs he and she, but I think more efforts on that. But really, thank you very much for me. I glow when thank I see this development.
Thank you so much. No more. So let's try to address some of the questions and very quickly. So perhaps we can start, because I think that would be very quick. Is there going to be a phase two for iAccelerator here?
Let me answer that, and also I'll touch on other questions, but I'll be very quick.
Okay.
First of all, someone mentioned social behavioral change. I just wanted to mention the fact that for each social enterprise, we are working with them to make sure that they develop their own social impact metrics. So if your company is providing services that give young people access to sexual and reproductive health, we not only measure how many people access that information, but we also try and measure what happened after they access that information. Have you changed their life? Have you changed the behavior? So that's where we're going now with the phase two of the Innovation Accelerator, and that takes me to answering the second part of the question. Is there going to be a second phase? There is going to be a second phase. It's not immediately in the short time, in the near future. It's not going to be another innovation challenge. We are not going to accelerate more social enterprises, not for now at least. What we want to do right now is to expand the services by setting up the virtual, the Innovation Accelerator as a virtual platform, so that not only we contribute to accelerating a few social enterprises focusing on sexual and reproductive health, but we offer support via an online platform to all the social enterprises in the country that focus on sexual and reproductive health. On the platform, you will be able to find online courses on business development, and possibly you will be able to access mentorship services. So you will be able to book mentorship time with people that can help you set up your business, or you will be able to find UNFPA experts that might be able to help you, that might be able to help you doing quality assurance of your products. I'll stop there. But for concerning new innovation challenges, it's an idea that we have, because it's not exactly cheap to accelerate new social enterprises. What we're going to do is to now use the results of the first edition to possibly generate the attention and the enthusiasm of donors, so to be able to fund new innovation challenges. But it will take a while.
Okay, thank you. I hope that addressed your question. Another question that was asked is, how does free contraception work in Rwanda? Would you like to take that in 15 seconds?
So what works is, in district hospitals, when a woman comes to give birth, usually we offer either an intrauterine device or an implanon, and it's free, basically, when she's pregnant and she's about to deliver. That's what I meant by free. It's not free out there for you to buy, unfortunately. But then once they're in the hospital, they can actually get it for free. And we actually tell all of them that they can get it before they even leave the hospital. And then they can just come back for checkups. So that's how it works.
And then there was also a question. The question perhaps on abortion, and if anyone is tracking it, do we have anyone that could address this question, even from the audience? Yes. Could we get a microphone to Honorable Minister of Health, please?
Thank you. Thank you very much. I just wanted to build on what my colleague said, the young doctor. about availability of contraceptive services and reproductive health in health facilities in Rwanda. We have invested as a government in availing contraception in all the health facilities, including health centers. But we know that we even have community health workers operating at the community level, and they have been trained in providing information, first of all, because in Rwanda, we promote free choice. We educate people, we provide them with the full information, but they are the ones to choose if they can go for family planning or not. So community health workers are offering information, but they also provide pills and injectables. So those methods are available at the community level. I want also to talk about contraception in case of rape. By definition, having sex with an under 18 girl is a rape, by definition. And we have what we call, we have a policy on use of contraception in case of rape. We simply call these emergency contraceptive, and they are available in all health facilities. So I think we need to strengthen our communication strategy to make sure that every young girl in a remote area knows about this and knows that there is available methods at health facility and called emergency contraception. Thank you.
Thank you, thank you. So I think because we're really pressed for time, there's another session that is going to happen here. So this is why it's not because we don't want to continue the straight talk. So I would like to conclude this panel perhaps by having an intervention from Mariana, who is a radio personality that is very known in Rwanda, part of Urunana. And we had this conversation, everyone mentioned, we need to be comfortable talking about this with our parents. And she's been an example of a person that's been educating young girls in Rwanda about sexual and reproductive health. And she's sort of our aunt in the culture that you go to when you don't feel comfortable talking to your parents. So I know we do have allies in other generations as well that are willing to engage with us and provide us with the recommendation. So please, Mariana, you can share your words of wisdom with us.
Murakoze cyane. Ndagira ngo mbasabe munyemerere mbabwire mu Kinyarwanda. Murakoze, nitwa Mukamusoni Josephine, nkaba ndi umubyeyi ngishwa nama kubera ko nkunda urubyiruko cyane. Aho urubyiruko ruri simpabura ndishima cyane. Ndagira ngo rero tuganire gatoya ku byo bavuzeho. Urubyiruko rwacu dukunda ni ukuri urugendo murimo turaruzi. Kuko nubwo mundeba gutya nanjye nabaye muto nkamwe. Niyo mpamvu byo munyuramo byose mbizi. Ndagira ngo rero twibukiranye ni ukugenda ureba imbere ufite intego y'icyo ushaka kuzageraho y'uwo ushaka kuzaba we. Mukirinda mbere na mbere ibiyobyabwenge byatemwe iki gihe. Kuko iyo mubigiyemo birabahungabanya. Bikabatesha inzira nziza mwari mufite umurongo ukaba uratakaye. Mugasabwa kwimenya mukarinda umubiri wanyu. Umubiri wanyu, ubuzima bwanyu, nicyo cya mbere. Udafite ubuzima bwiza ntabwo wazagera mu iyo myaka mubona twagezemo. Rero nimusigasire ubuzima bwanyu. Mwirinde kugira inshuti mbi, mugira inshuti nziza. Mwirinde kugendera mu Kigali. Niko bavuga. Noneho mujye mwicarana n'ababyeyi banyu kuba bafite. Mwicarane mubaho umwanya, mubatega amatwi. Mwumve ibyo bababwira, mwumve inama zabo, impanuro zabo. Izo nizo zizabafasha kugera kure. Mwe kugendera mu rungano ngo rubabwire ibintu mwakire. Hari ababashukisha ibintu bitewe n'uko babona mwe nta bushobozi mwari mwagira. Nimumenye kwiyakira mwemere uko muri. Mwe kurarikira ibibasumba. buhoro buhoro namwe muzabigeraho mubibone bitabagoye mutabihawe nabandi icyo kintu ni mugitsinda rwose muzagera kure noneho mukazirikana ko Afrika ibarabakeneye mwese irabakeneye uko mwayisanze mwirinde kuzayisiga mutyo ahubwo muharanire kuzagira byinshi muyongeraho ibe nziza kurushaho nk'ubu niba mu myaka yanjye ya kera nge narigaga mu ishuri navuga mu ishuri kugira ngo mvugane n'inshuti yanjye nk'uko namwe mugira inshuti nkandika ku gapapuro nkagira gutya nkagashyira munsi y'intebe nkagateresha ikirenge nta n'urukweto twagiraga ntarwo twambaraga bikagenda bikagera kuri iyo nshuti yanjye nshatse kubwira akajambo ngo k'urukundo ariko mwebwe uyu munsi muri kuri WhatsApp murandika mukandikira umuntu uri mu kindi gihugu cya kure akabasubiza mukishimana urukundo rwanyu rugakomeza ariko twumvikane imugabanye umuvuduko mumenye gushungura sibyo dore muzubwenge murakuze he kugira umuntu ubashuka ngo niza WhatsApp ngo ibi nibi ngo ndaje ngo ibi nibi ndaje twebwe icyo gihe twari dufite amahirwe make yo kuhura nabo bahungu kuko ntabwo twagiraga aho dusohokera imyidagaduro yari mike naho mwebwe impande hose zirahari kandi nibyo iterambere ni ryiza pe ntabwo turirwanya ariko rero muryitwaremo neza rwose nk'abanyabwenge koko kuri ubwo buryo muzagira Afrika nziza kurushaho u Rwanda rwacu rugwiza cyane mwongere akanyu natwe tuvuge tuti kuko dufite urubyiruko rwiza runogeye igihugu abakobwa ni mudakomeza gutwara inda mutarageza igihe rwose muzubaka ingo nziza namwe mugere igihe mutanga inama mugire umumaro muwigirire mugire n'igihugu sibyo
yego
murakoze cyane ndabashimiye murakoze
thank you so much the panelists murakoze cyane mubyeyi Mariana for those who don't understand Kinyarwanda Mariana is one of our people here in Rwanda who are actually teaching the young people how to prevent teenage pregnancies. So I'd like to thank the panel, and please, as you join your seats, I don't know if Malyse has something to say before we close.
Since time is pressing, yeah. Let's proceed with the closing remarks. But thank you, everyone.
Yes.
And I wish we had more time.
Yeah, I'm so sorry. We have another session that is coming up after this one, so we can't really take this discussion longer. But I'd like to ask young people here in the room. We've been actually talking about teenage pregnancies, and everything happens because there's been sex. So, how many young men walk around in their wallet with a condom? Honestly, how many young ladies and young men prepare to have sex? Because everything starts with something very simple, which is having a safe sex. And, I don't need any answer, but that is really, really something that you should start thinking about. Making sure that if you're engaging sex, we're having a safe sex. So our minister has just mentioned family planning and everything. I'm not going to talk anything more, but I would like to actually tell you that Rwanda is hosting the 5th National Conference on Family Planning. And this is happening in November. And more than 3,500 people are coming here in Rwanda to talk about this very important topic. If young people can only use well contraception, they're actually going to tackle the unwanted pregnancies. So without taking further ado, I would like to welcome the UNFPA country representative to give us his remarks, and please welcome our guest of honor. Thank you.
Thank you, our MC Magnifique. You're really living up to your name. Honorable Minister of Youth, Botswana, Honorable Minister of Health from Rwanda, Your Excellency, the Ambassador of the EU, senior dignitaries here today, most importantly, the adolescent and youth leaders here today, good afternoon. On behalf of the One UN family and UNFPA, the United Nations Population Fund, it's a great pleasure to be a part of this important straight talk on the prevention of teenage pregnancy. Honorable ministers and ambassador, we appreciate you taking the time to be with us. It's a sign of encouragement and empowerment for all of us and for our youth leaders and partners of development with us. As highlighted this morning in the opening ceremony, we have more than 226 million young people between 15 and 24 in Africa. It's the highest population of youth in the world. And the investments that we're making today in these young people and the changes that we're making in the way they are engaged will dramatically shape the future of Africa. Young people's choices, their ideas, their innovations can transform our world if they're equipped with the right skills and given the right opportunities. And it's at the heart of the Global Agenda 2030, the AU Agenda's 2063, lying the issue of demographic dynamics that can offer an unprecedented opportunity for adolescents and young people to claim their rights, to realize their aspirations and transform our world. However, it doesn't happen automatically. And at this Youth Connekt Africa, we're discussing in a lot of the sessions youth empowerment, youth engagement, entrepreneurship, employment creation. However, what's coming from the session today is another key action for us to realize that demographic dividend is to ensure we're investing in young people's human capital, which includes expanding their access to youth-friendly health information and services and addressing teenage pregnancy. Harnessing the full potential of youth requires that young people are fully engaged, but also educated and healthy. When teenage pregnancy occurs, a girl's healthy development into adulthood is sideswiped, and her chances of achieving her full potential are placed at serious risk. Today, it's estimated that approximately 95% of teenage pregnancies occur in developing countries, with more than 36 million women becoming mothers before the age of 18. Investing in the prevention of teenage pregnancy is a best buy in global development. It contributes to realizing the SDGs. It improves the health of young people, their education, and can facilitate a more gender equal relationship. But it also means that the public policy actions need to equally address the social, cultural, and economic challenges many young mothers face, as we saw in the video and documentary today. Addressing teenage pregnancy is an essential strategy that can contribute to reducing poverty and the upward economic development for all. We're inspired today by the diverse panelists, the rich questions that came from the audience, and the different stakeholder perspectives, which will be key to achieving the transformation in Africa that we want to see. Our effective partnerships can embrace these diverse perspectives and employ a wide range of expertise needed to accelerate action to reduce teenage pregnancy. The message coming out from the session today is that teenage pregnancy is not a health issue alone. Fostering these synergies across different sectors and stakeholders is key. And at the center of that needs to be young people, with whom remains the key to unlocking the solutions, solutions that are developed by young people for young people. And with the just adopted UN Youth Strategy a few weeks ago at the General Assembly, we as the UN system recommit ourselves to the efforts to place young people in their rightful place at the center of development. Let's work together to support our young people to drive the social and economic transformation we want by encouraging them, by empowering them, and by using platforms like Youth Connekt Africa to unite them. With these few remarks, let me take the opportunity to convey our appreciation to our guest of honor, the Minister of Youth of Botswana, to our Honorable Minister of Health here in Rwanda, to the development partners and youth leaders that are with us today, thanking you for a rich contributions, for a rich dialogue, for a real straight talk. And I wish we had more time to take it a bit further. Let this be the start of a continued discussion. These few remarks, we thank you very much for the opportunity and wishing you the best for the remaining Youth Connekt Africa. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Of course, this discussion has to go to an end. And I'd like to thank everyone. And please keep tweeting and keep engaging in your different platforms. I hope that at some point in Africa, we're going to be able to end and beat the unwanted pregnancies. So I'm reminded that there's someone who has to make some few interventions. I'd like to welcome the Minister of Youth from Botswana to give us his insight.
Thank you very much, Director of Ceremonies. Let me recognize the presence of Minister of Health and Rwanda and all dignitaries here present. I'm just coming here to say hello. I love you all. Is that all right? You know, no, actually, because we ran out of time, I said to the organizers that, well, it's fine. I don't have to delay the next program. But with the deliberations and answers and questions, you know, response from the panel, that was beautiful, that was great. We have similar challenges in all African countries. In my country, this teenage pregnancy is more common in rural areas. So this is where we need everybody to be involved. We need more research so that we could direct our resources, you know, to the right place. I don't know whether I was actually, you know, chosen to be here by coincidence or something, or the organizers Googled me. You know, over and above being the Minister of Youth Empowerment, Sport and Culture Development, I also have a foundation, called Tapelolopeng Foundation Trust. One of the programs in the foundation is the Young Mothers Program, you know, where we, you know, target young mothers, you know, we bring them together, we give them counseling, you know, they're empowered, they're taken back to school, you know, some that are given programs, you know, and they're skilled and be given programs to, you know, empower themselves economically. But there's something unique that we do, which is, different to others. You know, when a young mother enrolls into our organization, they fill in a form, and within that form, there's where they fill the details of the father. You know, this is not common. We had to go through a lot of legal advice on this, because you go to a stage where you even go for DNA test. You know, and the reason why we follow the fathers is not necessarily for them to come back into the relationship. It's for them to own up, because they are fathers. Like, as the director of ceremony said before, that these young girls, they don't get pregnant on their own. You know, there are those little boys, there are even grown-up men, those who, sleep with these little girls and cause, teenage pregnancies. So without, taking much of your time, thank you very much for such great, liberations. It is a complex challenge that we have as a continent. We have to make sure that we all deal with it and make sure that we break those cultural barriers, that bounds us to talk about sex openly with our children and educate them better. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you so much, everyone. Now we've come to an end. And I'd like to tell you that in this same room, there's going to be another session, which is going to be about connecting girls. And then I think it's actually going to be the same flow of conversation. So if you actually weren't even able to talk to this session, please stay. And we welcome everyone to stay for the next session. So I'd like to thank everyone, the partners, for making this happen. We sure are going to change Africa. Thank you so much.